For any of us who don't have a personal connection to the legislature or don't spend most of our time at the Roundhouse during a session, the media is our gateway to what's happening in the halls of government. So this week, we've pulled four journalists out of the Roundhouse to sit down with NMIF producer Matt Grubbs and talk about their takeaways from the legislative session and what it means for the legislature going forward.
We have managed to pull four of the Capitol Press Corps out of the Capitol down here to Albuquerque. Matt Reichbach with Clearly New Mexico online. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. And Rob Nicoleski, sometime panelist on the line. Thanks for coming back. We appreciate it.
Glad to be here.
Absolutely. Dan Boyd of the Albuquerque Journal, state Capitol reporter. Thanks, Dan.
Thank you.
And Tripp Jennings of the Santa Fe New Mexican, also.
Thanks for inviting me.
Somewhat familiar face. You bet. Well, we're here to sort of hash out our takeaways from the session, the 2012 session. Why don't we start with what they were there for, the budget. $40 million roughly in tax breaks. Rob, why don't we start with you? Was that enough for Susana Martinez to call this a win?
That's a really good question. She's indicated that she likes the budget. She's got until March to decide whether or not she's going to veto it, or at least line item vetoes a few things. And she says she'll look over it very carefully. But I think that's really a good question to find out whether there was enough to satisfy her on that.
Matt, what about your thoughts?
Well, I think the budget was really an example of how the session was kind of boring this year, is that they had an agreement coming in. It was unanimous. And I think it's not something that everybody's happy with, but it's something that everybody can live with.
Sure, sure. And Dan, once this kind of bogged down in the House Appropriations and Finance Committee, there was a deal, as Matt mentioned, going behind the scenes to sort of get more of the governor's priorities to have higher standing within that budget. Was really the game over once that hit the House floor?
I think that was part of it. And I think also there was some concern about what happens if revenues don't materialize. There's some concerns about natural gas, things like that. And so I think part of that was crafting language. What happens, you know, if the state doesn't take in as much money as we expect? And the governor, you know, had some certain thoughts on that. I think they were able to finally craft a deal with her. So there may be some more line item vetoes, but I don't think there'll be any big problems with the budget.
Sure. And that worry trip about there not being enough money if gas revenues go down, something like that, that was a big if, you know, all the John Arthur Smiths and the folks who are kind of the hawks watching it. I remember Lucky Varela saying, we've put so many automatic gates and closures in here and what ifs, because nobody wants to come back. Nobody wants to come back, you know, from August on, because they're all running for re-election.
Right, right. No, what's interesting is that John Arthur Smith still is concerned about the revenues, even though there was the consensus revenue estimate that was agreed upon by everyone, the legislative, the transportation fund, the administration. So it'll be very interesting to watch this. And of course, Smith was right a few years back. In 2008, when he was calling for a decline in revenues, and no one really believed him, at least in Richardson's administration. And I think those of us who were covering the special session in 2008 watched the revenue estimates go down day by day. And so it'll be interesting to see how it plays out this year.
It's really hard to get these guys to not spend money when there's when there's money there. I mean, it seems like they're bound to take it.
Yeah, and it reminds me of what Stuart Engel told me about a year and a half ago, when he was saying, because a lot of the conversation about this particular session is that they didn't get enough done. And I'm reminded of what Stuart Engel said, that sometimes it's good for us here in the legislature, but we don't do anything. the less we do, the less damage we can do.
Sure. There are certainly a lot of Republicans who feel that way.
Well, I think legislatures themselves, Congress and all 50 legislatures out there, these things are built to kill things. These things are not necessarily built to pass things. That's why you may have seen 800 bills. I don't know how many were filed. I don't know how many passed, but I think it was 100 or fewer.
Yeah, Dan said 77.
77 bills.
77, okay.
Yeah. It's the fewest number since
1976. So I think that is indicative of, you know, and partly some election year dynamics at work, but then also partly just the, you know, how daunting the system can be to try and get bills through.
Yeah, in a 30-day session with a Republican governor, Democratic legislature, they weren't really on the same page. Mm-hmm. And there's enough Republicans in the House to, all they have to do is chip off one or two Democrats and proposal's dead.
Sure, yeah.
That came into play a lot this year.
Yeah, we saw that time and again with a few fairly important measures, whether it's social promotion, something mm-hmm. like that. Did any of you get a feel for social promotion that there was traction made on the part of the governor this year so that when they come back and she tries it again, because it seems as though she will, that she'll have a little more footing?
Going into the session, you're asking about whether she was able to pull together more votes, right, on the House?
Yeah, or just make some headway.
I think with a legislature, one lawmaker can matter. And in that case, it's the House Speaker in the House and the Senate Majority Leader in the Senate. The Senate Majority Leader did not like this bill. And I think he'll say that, he wasn't the only one holding this up, and he wasn't. Mm-hmm. But someone like Michael Sanchez does control the pipeline. And unless you have the leadership on your side, you can have 70-0 in the House and 41-1 in the Senate, and this may not go.
And also on the House side, too, Speaker Lujan wasn't crazy about this because Mary Helen Garcia had a social promotion bill that was ready to go, and she felt that he was slow walking it. She wanted to blast it onto the floor. And he preempted her. It cost them a very crucial day at the end of the session. And then on the final day, the Republicans tried to leapfrog it, try to get it onto the floor. It did pass with a majority as far as trying to leapfrog it on the agenda, but it needed a two-thirds majority, according to the Speaker. So a lot of time got killed. And yet the fact that you're asking whether or not there's some traction there, I think there is, because I think probably most people on this panel would agree that if it had gone to the House floor for a vote, it probably would have passed.
So it gets through one. And then you're over to the Senate side.
And I think that it was closer, that one, than the driver's license, where I think everyone kind of acknowledged that they're at a gridlock on that issue. And I think you could maybe say the social promotion, they did just run out of time. I think maybe another day, I mean, who knows, but there might have been some kind of a deal that could be worked out there. Whereas on some other issues, I think, you could have had a 60-day session and it wouldn't have been any different on those.
Yeah, and the social promotion bill they talked about on the last day was that it already passed the Senate.
Right. Yeah. Oh, that's
so,
right. Yeah.
Yeah, because it was a John Arthur Smith
co-sponsored
bill, not the Mary Helen bill.
And it went through judiciary and then finally got to the floor. Absolutely. Well, it brings to mind something that, Rob, you referenced earlier, which is the personalities involved in this. We have Ben Lujan's last session, one in which he desperately wanted to just hit the finish line. But also really impacted some legislation. We had one of the most intriguing guys in the legislature, Michael Sanchez, just to my way of thinking, because he does have so much control over there on the Senate side, and then the governor, who maybe now has her feet under her more than she did in that last session.
Can I throw in a couple of names that were surprising to me?
On the personality front?
Personality front,
yeah.
Paul Bandy and David mm-hmm. Chavez.
Yep.
And the reason I say that is because there was Senate Bill 9, which was a highly, highly controversial bill with the administration. Paul Bandy and David Chavez, both Republicans, voted with Democrats to send that up to the governor. And she said she was going to veto it all session long, and then she kind of wasn't so absolute on the last day.
Yeah, although Chavez did not vote for it when it went to the floor.
Oh, he did not.
Bandy did. And here's another personality to throw out there. I mean, I wrote about it on my website. Bandy made this principled stand. He felt that this was a good bill, that this anti-big box bill was a good bill, and he voted for it in committee and voted for it on the floor. It was a two-vote swing. Diane Hamilton, a Republican who probably would have voted against it, was absent.
Sure.
But if Bandy votes for it and it doesn't pass, the reason why it might not have passed was because Kiki Saavedra, a Democrat, voted against it. So I think Representative Saavedra should be sending Paul Bandy a box of chocolates, because the story would not be, hey, House Bill 9, this bill that many people on the left love, has made it to the governor's desk, not necessarily because of Bandy, but if it had not made it, it wouldn't have made it because of Kiki Saavedra.
And I think he said people on the left really like it. One reason is they see it as a really good election issue. They see mm-hmm. it as supporting local businesses over Walmart. We see how many times Walmart gets public attention against them when they're moving into the neighborhood, because they say it kills all the mom and pop shops.
Right.
And I think that this is a bill they think if she vetoes it, then they have
some election
mm-hmm. ads. And if she signs it, then they have a really good issue that they passed.
And it's important to note that it has never made it to either chamber's floor in the right. 7 years prior to Peter Wirth pushing this.
Right, offering it first as representative and then as a senator. Yeah. What about this personality? Is it a personality conflict? Is it an ideological conflict between Michael Sanchez and Susana Martinez? What do you think, Dan?
I think they're... You know, some of it is, I think, philosophical, and you know, politics can get personal sometimes too, as we all know. I think this year one thing we saw differently than last year was, instead of just playing defense, I think the Democrats on some of the big issues, you know, pushed their own bills forward, and so they were offering a kind of a different vision. And I think you know, on some of those there was some room for compromise, but it was, I think, designed to give voters two different alternatives instead of just I think last year the governor was really pushing her agenda on a lot of issues, and this year they said, hey, we have our own ideas on some of these hot button issues, driver's licenses, social sure. promotion, and ultimately nothing ended up happening on those. But
sure, Matt, did it feel to you like Democrats, both in the Senate and then we saw maybe a week later in the House with sort of their jobs initiative, the higher initiative for Senate Democrats, did it feel to you like they were testing the water at all and that next session they might get a little more organized and both come out with a similar plan?
I think that it's that, and also they realized that Susana Martinez can be very aggressive. I don't think they were ready for that.
Sure.
Because it's been 8 years since there was a Republican in office, and Gary Johnson wasn't pushing his agenda as strongly as Martinez was. She's sending the robocalls mm-hmm. in against them. There's mailers against some of the legislators. And I don't think they were ready for that kind of high-powered attack against them. So then they finally came out with a counterattack this session, and I think they feel they did a little bit better.
Sure. And this is sort of a tactic that we saw a little bit with Richardson when he was pushing his constitutional amendments to take more money out of the permanent fund back in 2003. And he just basically started campaigning in all these people's yep. hometowns.
Yes.
And, you know, it made heads turn pretty quickly.
I mean, I think that for political reporters, all of us sitting around the table, this is going to be a really interesting year because you do have an aggressive governor. You do have Democrats who are starting to fight back, like Matt said. You're going to see people targeted. There are even some stories out there suggesting that Martinez is going after fellow Republicans who don't press her agenda. It's one of these things where, you know, I get kind of giddy thinking about all the drama going that we're going to be able to cover.
Sure, absolutely. Year. Well, it sort of starts with redistricting. We're all sitting here still waiting to see if what Judge Hall comes up with will be acceptable to the Supreme Court and whether or not the feds will step in at some point. How much did that sort of specter of redistricting hang over people, specifically in the House?
Oh, I think it was a big specter. It was space ghost hanging over everyone's heads because the House is so competitive. It's 36-33-1 with Democrats in favor. And if redistricting, if the original redistricting map had been adopted, I think that there would have been an excellent chance for Republicans to take over. And there still might be. I've talked to some Republicans who think that even the two options that Judge Hall is looking at now, that Republicans feel cautiously optimistic that they can take over the House for the first time, I think, in like 50 or 60 years.
The 40s, maybe?
Yeah. I think back to the Eisenhower administration, or maybe even earlier than that.
Yeah. So that when they go to the floor on some of these key votes, like a social promotion, maybe even that we see with a driver's license, how much is the election year 2012 playing into their minds, do you think? I mean, it's impossible to know, but just based on the behavior that you've seen this session versus last.
I think it's definitely there. I mean, we even saw some change in the driver's license vote on the House floor, and I don't think that was an accident. And I think they all know that this is going to be an issue that's going to be raised and probably raised aggressively in the upcoming election. So I mean, not, you know, it's hard to say for each person how much that factors in, but I think it, you know, you can't deny that that's kind of in the background on every vote, not just the driver's licenses this year.
What about the fact that we're going to see a new speaker, whether it's somebody like Joe Cervantes, who maybe is more of a candidate who, if Republicans don't have the majority, is at least somewhat appealing to them versus, say, Kenny Martinez, or, you know, do we see like a Tom Taylor or something?
I've heard Rick Miera's number, Rick Miera's name being tossed about.
Really?
Among Democrats, yes.
He's been out there for more than a year.
How much will that play into what we see happen in the House next year, do you think?
It's going to be everything. The Speaker, I mean, we've seen how much Ben Lujan controls what goes on in the House and infuriates his opponents, but he gets stuff done, and it'll be interesting to see if the new Speaker is going to be as aggressive as he was. It'll really be interesting to see what kind of district they're from to see if they're safe. As we saw, though, as we saw last election, Lujan wasn't exactly safe. He almost got taken out.
The other interesting thing that ties into that, it also ties into redistricting, is now the Judge Hall knows that Ben Lujan is retiring. Mm-hmm. Now you can consolidate that District 46 up in the North Central area. Before it was sort of, you know, you don't want to touch the Speaker's district.
Sure.
Now that's in play.
And, you know, election year is almost everything in this, because we can talk and we can speculate, but is it going to be 33 and 2, or 33 and 33 and 4,
that's
or 30.
Math.
Exactly. I mean, did it add up to 70? I don't even know. But it's really going to be interesting, because what happens if it's for some reason Andy Nunes decides to become a Democrat again, because the Speaker is not there? What if it's 35-35?
Right.
Sure.
You know, who knows?
It's going to be a great year. Guys, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.